strength and our hope. Amen. Well, that's interesting. The same person, we think the same person, whose name might not have been Luke, but it's still the same person, wrote the Gospel of Luke and the book of the Acts of the Apostles, right? Which generally, the life of Jesus, life after Jesus, and concluded the Gospel of Luke with the story of Jesus ascending, and then opened the book of Acts with the story of Jesus ascending. Theophilus, by the way, is just, it's an address. Like, it reads, it's a guy or a woman. It could be anybody. But it's a way of addressing the beginning of a story, right? In those days, people would say, I'm writing to so-and-so. It doesn't mean it's specifically just intended for that person. It's just a form of address. But the point is, whoever wrote those two things separately ended Volume 1 with a story that they then began Volume 2 with. And they're not exactly the same. It's not like Volume 2 begins with recap, right? So you can, like, press the skip recap button, and it... No? Okay. It's not exactly the same story, but it gets repeated. So obviously who wrote this thought it was important. So why don't we think it's so important? Because we tend not to. We tend to gloss over this story quite frequently, or at least not give it the attention it deserves. And that might be, as I mentioned, it might be because it occurs a specific number of days after Easter, which means it invariably falls during the week. Here we are on Sunday. It could also be the kind of supernatural nature of the story. Jesus is there, and then he's not. And in one version, it's just kind of like he kind of disappears, and then the other one, clouds. Clouds are significant, by the way, because clouds are always a sign of the presence of God. On the other hand, Pentecost is a big deal, and we love making a fuss over the whole tongues of flame, wind, all that kind of stuff. We love the supernatural nature of that story. So why do we have so much trouble with this sort of ascension story where Jesus, you know, ascends into heaven? Maybe we don't know what to do with it. That was foreshadowing, by the way. But maybe we don't know exactly what to do with it. Which is surprising also, because here we are in the era of CGI. This is a story that very much, just like the Pentecost story, lends itself to lots of special effects. It does. And in fact, I'm going to show you five short, really short little clips that represent the ascension story. Two of them are specifically the story. The other three are not. See if you can tell which are which. Graham?
You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Go into the world and preach the gospel to all creation.
Where's he gone?
Yeshua!
Where was he?
Here?
Come on!
Yeshua!
Brother!
Brothers.
I go to prepare a place for you. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And know that I will be with you always.
You.
I may have miscounted. There was a fifth clip. Well, I'll just tell you what it is because it only lasted 6 seconds. It was Captain Kirk beaming. If you're not a Star Trek fan, never mind. The point is, all of that, let me just tell you about those in order because I'm sure you've seen all of those movies. Captain Kirk famously, right, on Star Trek, the transporter, they beam. Right? There's this shimmering light, and then they're gone. And they reappear somewhere else miraculously. Science, which most scientists tell you, is absolutely impossible. Everything else in Star Trek is real. Before that, if you haven't seen Ghostbusters Afterlife, that's the scene where the ghost of Egon, one of the former Ghostbusters, saves the day, basically, and then disappears into heaven, having reconnected with his daughter from whom he has been apart for a very long time. And before that, it was from Field of Dreams, and that's a scene where at the end of the movie, Shoeless Joe Jackson walks into the cornfield and disappears where he had come from. Right? The two clips before that are obviously the ones that are the story. One is from the movie Risen. The second one, I guess, is from the movie Risen, and simply shows Jesus backing into the dawn and disappearing. There's a bit of a rush of a wind there, but basically he just backs into the dawn and he's gone, which is kind of reminiscent of the end of the Gospel of Luke. And then, of course, the first one, that's a lot of CGI there. That's a lot of imagery taken from one passing reference to clouds. But it's pretty powerful and kind of spectacular. You can see, in fact, whoever interpreted that also interpreted into it either the presence of angels or other prophets of history appearing to welcome Jesus to heaven. Can you guess which one of those, though, is my favorite representation of how the ascension story really works? Don't say Captain Kirk. You didn't even see that one. It's the one from Field of Dreams. It's the one from Field of Dreams because what happens is essentially the character disappears into, well, everything, the earth. The others, even the Ghostbusters movie, which, I mean, it's Ghostbusters, you know, disappears skyward as if heaven is up, which 2,000 years ago they thought it was. But is it? Particularly when the point of the story isn't all those special effects. The point isn't a spectacular moment. In fact, the story, how we tend to see the story, might very well be a metaphor for church generally. We're looking for the spectacular moment, the special effects. That might even be what brings people in the door. But what keeps them connected isn't that moment. It's the story and the meaning that's behind it, which is precisely why I most like the one from Field of Dreams. It's because Joe basically walks into the cornfield and disappears into the earth, into everything. He's just there. Gone, but still there. Which I think is precisely the point of the ascension story. All of the talk leading up to the ascension story is Jesus telling them things like we heard last week about how I will be gone, but I'll always be with you. Huh? How does that work? Well, my physical representation will be gone, but I am always with you. I am in you, always. Just as God is in all of us, always. In fact, I think the most spectacular moment, most important moment, most beautiful, meaningful moment of this sort of progression from Easter to Pentecost is in this moment. Death and resurrection, the Holy Spirit, and in the middle of that is the thing that connects everything. The idea that I am always with you. All of the things that I taught you, all of the things that I showed you, all of the experience you shared with me is now in you. I'm going to backtrack on something I used to say lots. Remember when I tried to get people to start using the word Jesusing? Because Jesus is a verb. So we all do good Jesusing. It didn't really take, so if you don't remember, I'm not surprised. But Jesus is a verb, and the idea, I think, is still particularly sound. The thing is, we don't do Jesusing. We don't be Jesus. We be Jesus in us. As if Jesus is gone, but is still in us, the way we know Jesus. So no, you're not expected to be exactly like Jesus. What we want is to feel that power that Jesus showed us is in all of us being expressed through who we are. So when Jesus says to the disciples, go and be me to everyone, go and be me to the world, he means the me that is in you. Don't grow a beard, dress funny, and start wearing sandals. Don't start saying thee and thou a lot. Be who you are, expressing that power of God that is within you. Having trouble with that? Let me tell you a little story about something called the Holy Spirit coming upon the disciples and inspiring them to be able to suddenly communicate with everyone in the language they each understand, a language of their home, which is more the point, that they are connecting from their home with their home. The thing about that is, we tell the story as if the Holy Spirit comes upon them, as if it's an outside force that goes Shazam. So there's a better way to represent that. It's probably, you've seen those scenes where, you know, smacks them on the forehead, they fall over and suddenly they're healed. That's not what the Spirit is about. It's not an outside force that you're going to sit and wait for. Unfortunately, we tell this story where Jesus says, sit and wait for the Holy Spirit. It will come upon you. And then a few days later, sure enough, Pentecost, Shazam, we're all. I don't think that's how it happens. I think the Holy Spirit is already in us. It's a question of releasing it. It's a question of realizing in some moment of how that can be shown to the world. Because why? We already know it is in us. Because Jesus left, but he's still here. Because God is present in all things. If God is present in all things, God is in you. God is in the world. The Holy Spirit is our realization that we can share that. That we can be inspired, empowered, whatever words you want to use there, to be that in the world. From who we each uniquely are. If you haven't seen the movie Field of Dreams, by the way, shame on you. But if you haven't seen the movie Field of Dreams, what happens right after that scene, when Joe disappears into the corn and says, no, it was you, Ray. It comes from the beginning of the movie where Ray hears the words, if you build it, he will come. And he thinks building the baseball diamond brings shoeless Joe Jackson. It doesn't. It brings his dad, who he had long lost contact with. And right after that scene, he turns and he sees his dad. And he gets to have a moment with his dad that he never had, playing catch. Again, the ascension story isn't about that moment of glory where the clouds and all that stuff happen. It's about how that doesn't go away. In those next moments, I don't think the disciples sat on their hands in Jerusalem waiting for something to happen. I think they started to make things happen. And because they started to make things happen, we can tell that wonderful story where they had a moment of realization of how to make things happen even better. But each of us, uniquely, individually ourselves, has a way to do that, has a way to express the power of God that is within us. We sometimes call them gifts or talents or skills and things like that. Creativity. We're all creative every moment of what we do, however we do it. We're always, the way we respond to things, we're always creating. again, the power of God working through you, through all of us.